there's been too many sort of like unwritten rules on how to do in order to be a drag. For me, drag is almost like a caricature of the gender binary, and it just expresses it on such a high level that it's almost like a cartoon version of gender.
Mostly I do like a lot of work in basements. Like to like 40, 50, 100 people with a lot of alcohol and like really bad lighting.
I always walk past here on, you know, Wednesdays, Fridays, Saturdays in drag, and all I get is, hey, way, just like that. Oh, you look wicked, you do. Ah! And that's it. Whereas if I was just a girl on a night out, I know then it would be a different response. But because I've got this beard on, I have the confidence of thinking, nobody's going to speak to me because I'm a man.
If I'm in a lot more of like a toned down sort of outfit or costume or whatever, I have had people sort of like take a double take or ask like, is that beard real and stuff like that. But from the most part, I feel like people can kind of tell that I'm a drag king just because, you know, I'm 4'11". Like, I'm not a tall guy. My name's George, I'm 29 years old, approaching 30. Oh. My drag name is George Roper. The whole name behind like George Roper is wanting to sort of cause a scene, wanting to sort of shock people and make their jaw literally drop. Do you know what I mean? It's sort of like a play on words with that. I think the first time I did drag was maybe November, December time, maybe a little bit after. So it's only been since the end of last year, beginning of this year. So it is still very much something new. Based on like my own experiences with like stereotyping and like the toxic masculinity and things like that, I've absolutely like taken little snippets of those things and compiled them into like my character. Sort of like that cocky geezer that just sort of like you'll see at the pub, you know, that dickhead that you see and you're just like, oh my god, that's George, that is George Roper. Allowing myself this time to be able to create this character as almost like taking everything that I have experienced, spun it around and almost like pushed it back out onto that toxicity and being like, and mirrored it and almost being like, this is how you behave. This is not good, is it? This is quite not okay. Yeah, I feel like the final touches for the beard then is just going over with just a trusty mascara wand and just sort of catching those little baby hairs that you have on your face and sort of like dabbing in, and it gives you that sort of like mottled hair effect, I guess. So what I'm about to put on today is probably one of like the newest couple of bits that I've got, but it's very much inspired by glam rock showman / gangster. I think that drag kings are very important in the UK queer scene. It's very important to be able to show, you know, a masculine side to that queer community, because there's so much like negative talk as well about how people like to stereotype. I think stereotyping is only based on people's own sort of like shitty evaluations and judgments and perspectives. I feel like opening that perspective and showing different elements of performance and masculinity within a person, I think it will just help bring a lot of people together, whether that's someone who's struggling with their gender themselves, whether that's someone who's maybe grown up feeling like, I'm not like other people, I'm not like my friends. Hopefully, by doing what we do, it sort of opens up that space for people who, to be able to recognise and see themselves maybe in one of us, or vice versa. You know, like, if I'm performing, there may be someone in the crowd where I'm like, that was absolutely me a few years back. You know, and it's just really nice to be able to connect with people that are just on your level.
My name is Len Gwynn, I'm 30. For a second I thought I was 31. That's just the temperature today. And my drag name is Len Blanco. Over the last 6 years has been mostly fun. I was on the BBC on a primetime show called All Together Now. BBC makeup artist did like a full beard, like the first proper full beard that I'd ever had done. And I walked out on stage and I could tell that the like 100 people that were looking at me were like, what? They just couldn't quite understand who or what they were looking at. And then I saw the one drag queen in the audience go, that's a drag king.
So we're gonna do makeup, working on like getting a like more typically masculine face. And then we're gonna put like some clothes on.
So I run drag king workshops. It's basically me taking a small group of like of 10 people and we share ideas about what drag is, and I help them to build a drag king persona and a drag king act, and then they perform it at the end of the 7 or 8 weeks. I know that there are so many people out there who have seen drag kings or have heard about drag kings, and that's unlocked something in them that they really, really want to do.
Like just cold pencil around the bottom, outside edge of the eyes. Just to, like, again, it kind of makes your eyes look a bit darker and a little bit further set back.
As AFAB people, assigned female at birth people, we get misogyny all the time. And we get sexism all the time. And to be able to become a man or play a different role is the option of freedom and liberation for that time. And the opportunity to take back a degree of control and power and to explore what it's like to be a different person. I have a feeling or a fear that is based on other people's experiences as well as my own, that people will take me more seriously in drag because I've got moustache on, and they will laugh more at my jokes when I appear male than if I were to turn up like this.
Right, so what we're going to do is we're going to channel our inner problematic man. We're going to start with boy band members. Okay, boy band members. Come, Liam and Payne. 3, 2, 1, go! Yeah. Make that money. Turn around, pose. Yes!
Drag is inescapably political. Even if you're doing something really stupid and like, if you're doing like clowning about, I don't know, popcorn, I think it's still political because it's still playing with gender. and we live in a society that governs us with ideas of gender. Drag queens and drag kings are all taking the piss out of how gender defines us and how gender decides what we do and who we are and what our lives look like. You know, people know about drag queens and now they're starting to know about drag kings. And again, it's like, oh yeah, here's the binary. So the mainstream is understanding it in binary terms. It's like, it's so much more interesting than the binary. And there are so many ways that queens and kings both play with the binary and just go to the binary. Gonna set the flag, gonna drown them out. This is breath, this is breath, this is who I'm meant to be. This is me. Woo! Not to see right girl.
By The Greatest Showman, that's always just trying to say, like, I'm not afraid to show my scars, I'm not afraid to be who I am. My name is Ren, and I'm 29 then, but no, I'm 31, and I live in Cardiff. I have lived here nearly all my life, gone in and out of certain places, but home is Cardiff for me. And my name is just in drag when I'm in drag. Won't you share this with me? 'Cause darling, without you.
Without further ado, I give you your groom, Justin Drag, and his best man, Jaw Dropper. Pause for applause. Here we go. Give it up for Justin Drag!
So I've been doing drag since 2016. By being just in drag, being that persona and having the beard and everything just allowed me to understand who I actually was. I felt way more comfortable in my skin when I was as Justin. So then that's when I started to transition in 2020. When I was in lockdown, I sort of sat with my feelings and thought, I've been doing drag for many years. I hate wearing binders. I feel uncomfortable. What can I do? And then that's when I transitioned, and last October I had my top surgery, and I'm going to be going through the processes of transitioning. So I think drag has really empowered the way I am and understand who I am as Ren. So as a man, you have, you know, they tend to have sort of like dimples in their chins. They're a lot more chiseled. You know, certain individuals, their eye sockets are a lot darker, deeper, and their temples. So for example, I put stuff here to sort of indent my temples there. It's funny because when I first started doing drag, that was my whole persona, that I was like the typical man that you'd see out on a street or in a club and you didn't want him to approach you. I was that. I was like, come here, darling, come over here, sweetheart, give us a kiss, you know? I was this. But I then realised that nobody wants that, so why should I be that? And don't get me wrong, there's parts of me where I am, like I said, I am still that cheeky chappy, and I'll still have a flirt. You sort of learn and grow that you can't say certain things and do things. But I think that's just because of, I grew up in a family where, you know, my father wasn't particularly, you know, the kindest or nicest around, you know, genders, race, sexuality. And sometimes, you know, when you're young, so you are taught hate, you're not born with hate. then you have to take a step back and think, no, learn, because that's how you're going to be able to grow. And that's what I'm trying to do now with people in the trans community, try and get them to understand that whatever opinion you had of a tranny or trans person, that you need to treat it this way now, because this is a human being. And you know, it's the same for race, gender, sexuality. You just gotta, you know, respect people.